Hello, I'm Janos Szurdi, and in this presentation I will introduce our quest to better understand abusive TDSs, short for traffic distribution systems. You can think of TDSs as the malicious counterparts of advertisement networks. As we know, user traffic is one of the most valuable assets on the internet, and cybercriminals want a share of it. Traffic distribution systems connect questionable and malicious sites desiring very specific user traffic with sites attracting these users. For example, phone users who want to watch movies for free are sent to a variety of deceptive and scam pages. The goal of our work is to provide a better understanding of how these traffic distribution systems operate. I will start by first discussing common methods for sites to monetize user traffic. In case of pay-per-click, when a user visits a site, and the site shows a bunch of ads to this user, only if the user is interested in an ad and clicks on it is when the user will be redirected through multiple entities to finally arrive on the advertiser's webpage. Differently, in case of pay-per redirect, which is more common in traffic distribution systems, if a user visits a site, in this example mistypes wikipedia.org, which we call a traffic source, the user will be automatically redirected through multiple entities we call the traffic brokers to finally arrive on the destination page, in this example, a technical support scam page. To give you an example of how this looks like in real life, I wanted to visit steampower.com. However, I made a typing mistake and I was redirected through multiple domain names to finally arrive on a site that told me that my Flash player is outdated and I should install the newest version. Making the same typing mistake again, you will see how I was again redirected through multiple domain names. However, this time I ended up on a very different destination page.
Important security message. Your computer has been locked up. Please do not attempt to shut down or restart your computer. Doing that may lead to data loss and identity theft.
You can imagine how this type of technical support scam page might scare unsuspecting users into paying the scammers. We had three main questions about traffic distribution systems. First, previous research studying illicit pharmacies and sites selling counterfeit products have found that they operate independently. We are wondering if this still holds true and whether if it's true for other traffic sources, such as copyright infringing sites streaming movies for free and typo-squatting domains monetizing users' typing mistakes. Second, we ask the question whether studying these illicit networks as only one type of user is sufficient, or they differentiate users based on factors such as the device used. And third, we're curious to see if these illicit traffic sources and TDSs try to hamper our efforts to study them. For example, by leveraging a technique called cloaking, where they would hide malicious content from suspected security researchers and bots. And while cloaking has been widely studied, we found the previous studies of illicit traffic sources and TDSs before 2016 rarely considered cloaking, and even after 2016, the vast majority of these papers only considered user agent-based cloaking. However, studying traffic distribution systems is a measurement in an adversarial setting, where the goal of the adversary is to send users to malicious landing pages while hiding from security researchers to maximize profit. To give you a few examples, a TDS would cloak their malicious activity if they see a visit coming from a data center IP, or if they see too many requests from too few IP addresses. Some TDSs would only show malicious content if certain HTTP headers are set. Furthermore, if they would detect that a visit comes from a bot because it cannot handle cookies or JavaScript, then they would also only show benign content. To give you a few examples, this is what oclabor.org looks like when visited by a normal user. However, to Google's bots, they will show this keyword stop page in order to increase their rankings in search engine results. And finally, they will redirect users coming from a Google search to this illicit pharmacy page. And we found that by setting the referrer header to be google.com, we observed 252% more illicit pharmacies. In another example, when I visited a typo-squatting domain name, I was redirected to this technical support scam page. The second time I visited the exact same domain, I was redirected to a site telling me that I was selected as a lucky customer to receive a $1,000 Visa gift card. However, after that, I was always redirected to a benign page, no matter how many times I tried. And we show that this type of IP-based cloaking is a serious issue if a crawler visits too many pages from too few IP addresses. To study traffic distribution systems and to address these issues, we designed ODIN, the Observatory and Detector of Illicit Ad Networks. ODIN collects URLs from four different traffic sources, known to redirect users to illicit, abusive, or malicious landing pages. All these sources acquire user traffic in a different manner. Typo-squatting domain names monetize users' typing mistakes. Illicit pharmacies profit from users searching for cheap drugs. Illicit movie streaming sites acquire user traffic by streaming movies for free, and ad-based URL shortening services provide short URLs in return to exposing users to these TDSs. ODIN visits each URL using a multiprocessing crawler based on a headless Chrome. It schedules URLs owned by the same entity as far in time as possible and limits the number of pages visited in a day. Also uses a different IP address for the different crawl profiles. All this to mitigate the effects of IP-based cloaking and blocking. Each URL is visited 6 times, emulating a normal user, a user coming from a Google search, a Google bot, and a no-proxy user, which I will explain in a little bit. ODIN also visits each URL using an emulated phone and the real phone. And it does this in order to understand if TDSs cloak their activity based on detecting phone emulation. All traffic goes through a man-in-the-middle proxy in order to collect all HTTP communication and to be able to modify headers on the fly. Also, for flexible IP use, we use transparent squid proxies, scrubbing all headers that would tell that we are using a proxy. However, WebRTC-based proxy detection is still possible. And to understand this, this is why we use a no-proxy user. Finally, ODIN extracts features automatically from the data collected for further analysis. We found that using 6 different profiles, ODIN discovers 81% more malicious landing pages than using the best performing profile only by itself. To better understand the effects of IP-based cloaking, we ran 2 experiments in parallel, studying the same set of URLs during the same time window. The only difference being that for one experiment, we used only 1 IP address, and for the other experiment, we used 240 IP addresses. We have seen that the number of error pages decreased when using 240 IP addresses, and the number of pages seen in the other categories increased. Most interestingly, we discovered that the number of malicious pages more than doubled using 240 IP addresses. Next to cloaking, another challenge in studying traffic distribution systems is user differentiation. On this graph, nodes are domain names, and edges are redirection between 2 domains. Blue nodes were visited by ODIN as a phone user, and red nodes were visited as a desktop user. Pink nodes were visited both as a phone and a desktop users. On this plot, red and blue clusters are destination page domain names and pink clusters are traffic source domain names. We can see how phone and desktop users are redirected to entirely different parts of the redirection chain graph. On this example, zooming in, red nodes are technical support scan pages shown to desktop users and blue nodes are deceptive survey pages shown to phone users. To give you 2 examples, if users mistype glassdoor.com using a phone, then they were redirected to a deceptive survey page shown on the left. But if they use a desktop, then they were redirected to benign pages represented by the hollow nodes. If other users mistype youtube.com using a phone, they were also sent to a similar deceptive survey page. However, this time if they use a desktop, then they were redirected to a deceptive download page telling them that their flash player is outdated and they need to install a new one. Note how this user differentiation can occur at different points in the redirection chain. Next, we discuss how these 4 very different traffic sources often rely on the same TDSs. On this plot, I show you the overlap of traffic broker domains among them. On the diagonal, we can see the total number of domains in each set. We can immediately see that illicit pharmacies rarely use traffic brokers, and they prefer to directly redirect users to the illicit stores. And even if they use a broker, it's not very likely that is a broker that is also used by the other street traffic sources. At the same time, the other street traffic sources often use the same traffic broker domains, in some cases nearly half of the time. Also, they often redirect users to the same or similar destination pages. To understand how blacklists perform in this adversarial setting, we studied Google Safe Browsing or GSB. On this plot, we show the delay of GSB compared to Odin. X-axis is the delay in days and Y-axis is the cumulative distribution of domains. Confirming previous research, we found the GSB rarely finds a domain name to be malicious before Odin, and on average it has a 7-day delay. Also, GSB finds 32% less malicious pages compared to Odin. Next to these known limitations, alarmingly, GSB finds 76% less malicious pages in case of phone users, showcasing the importance of studying TDSs as multiple different types of users. To address the limitations of blacklist, we trained a classifier to predict if a redirection will lead to a malicious page or not. Previous research has either built a redirection graph beforehand, which might change over time and is specific to the studied traffic sources, or relied heavily on the loaded malicious page exposing users to it. Differently, our classifier only relies on the single redirection chain visited by the user, excluding the final landing page. On this plot, I show you the precision and recall of our classifier, which could be used to warn users before landing on these malicious pages by setting the classification threshold to 90% precision and 89% recall, or directly block users from landing on malicious pages when we set this threshold to 99% precision with 42% recall. In summary, we observed that different illicit traffic sources often use the same TDSs, providing an opportunity to disrupt multiple illicit traffic sources and destination pages at the same time. We also found that future studies must take into consideration a wide variety of cloaking and blocking techniques if they want to accurately measure illicit and malicious activities. Furthermore, we must take into consideration user differentiation, as different types of users might have an entirely different experience in these illicit networks. This is especially true for blacklists who want to protect users but currently lack coverage, for example, for phone users. And finally, it is possible to protect users by predicting if a redirection will lead to a malicious landing page even before users land on them. I hope you enjoyed this presentation, and I'm looking forward to your questions.